नमस्ते। साइको एनालिसिस एंड फिलोसॉफी सेल्फ विथ एस कैपिटल ईस्ट एंड वेस्ट। सेल्फ इज एन एसोटेरिक कॉन्सेप्ट बोथ इन द ईस्ट एंड द वेस्ट। इन साइको एनालिसिस एस्पेशली द कॉन्सेप्ट इज यूज्ड इन अ वेरी यूनिक वे। सो लेट अस डिस्कस दिस टॉपिक डीपर विद आवर साइको एनालिसिस कंसल्टेंट मिस्टर हिमांशु वैद्य। नमस्ते मिस्टर वैद्य। Mr. Vaidya, can we start with what this word self with S capital really means in psychoanalysis and spirituality?
Self does not mean one thing in psychoanalysis and another thing in spirituality, which we can then compare and contrast. In fact, we are in a situation where within psychoanalysis, there are many meanings of the word self. Within spirituality, there are many meanings of the word self. And in normal parlance, there is a separate meaning of the word self. In everyday discourse, when we say self, we just refer to the person. So if I have to write an essay myself, I just say, my name is X. This is my gender, this is my height, this is how I look, this is where I live. A very ordinary use of the word self. But when we come to psychoanalysis, we see the word self used in three different ways. One, self can refer to the whole of the personality. Second, it can refer to what Jung calls the word self, or rather uses the word self to mean the center and the coordinator of the whole psychic system. So for Jung, the word self has a different meaning, a distinct meaning. It is the center of the personality. It is that part which is the seed in which the whole blueprint of the tree exists. And this is the part that governs the activation and deactivation of archetypes according to the program of life. This self also is the teleological center of the psyche. In the sense, this self has a purpose, and towards that purpose, it's individuating. And Jung's psyche also has a collective facet to it, in the sense that the collective part of the psychic system renders a transpersonal quality to the self. And if you look in psychoanalysis further, you have Kohut's use of the word self. And for Kohut, it is a phenomenological entity. And it is a very fluid entity, because Kohut does not define it very clearly. Although all of his psychology is called self-psychology, does not define the word self, although he has created the whole self-psychology. And therefore, Kohut's self actually moves, conceptually speaking, between the whole of the personality at one end and ego at the other. But it's closer to the whole of the personality at one end and quite away from the ego, except when Kohut starts talking about ego cohesion. And there at times we feel whether he is using the word self-cohesion and ego cohesion interchangeably. So Kohut's self is a very different self. So within psychoanalysis, we have Jung's use of the word self, which is very different from Kohut's use of the word self. And both of them are different from the common sense, everyday use of the word self. And then we come to spirituality. And in spirituality, again, there are many meanings of the word self. One meaning of the word self is that which is the anchor of everything, the big self, the capital self. Second use of the word self is to use it as what we call the soul, that which is moving from one incarnation to another. The third use of the word self is in some systems of spirituality where it refers to the psychological center of the person. Dr. Maheshwari calls it the individuality of the individual. And in the same system, another use of the word self is also what is called the central being. So that which evolves is the psychic being, and that which is above evolution is a central being. And the central being is a part of a larger expanse of one big self. So within spirit, and one more use in spirituality is that which partly governs us cannot govern us completely, because the self has to contend with forces of karma, free will, as well as circumstances. But to the extent it can, it tries to put its stamp on the personality as far as possible. And when we look at, broadly speaking, the way spirituality and psychoanalysis deal with the word self, we realize that the psychoanalytic approach to the word self is largely secular, does not deal really with spiritual aspect of the self or reality. Whereas in spirituality, the core engagement along with the word self is to go into the whole reincarnational part and the whole mystical part of reality and oneself. So the use of the word self in everyday parlance in psychoanalysis and spirituality is very different.
Then how is Jung's self different from Kohut's self, and that is different from the self in Indian spirituality? Can you elaborate on that?
Jung's self is a structural self. The Jung's self is not created in a phenomena. It is there inborn. And that coordinates the whole of the psyche to make sure individuation happens and the program of life is followed to the extent it can optimally do it. Jung's self also does not get in creation of pathology or directly in healing. Jung's self also does not get deformed, or lack of full formation does not happen because of a developmental arrest. And Jung's self has a collective and a transpersonal element to itself. Whereas if we go to Kohut's self, contrast to Jung's self, Kohut's self is not a structural self, it is a phenomenological self. It is created in the phenomena which happen after birth. And if certain experiences are not available, the arrest happens. And a full and realistic healthy self cannot be formed. And therefore, instead of a healthy self, a pathological self is formed. And that pathological self, we try to move it towards a healthy self in therapy by restarting the arrested developmental process. Kohut's self is also very deeply involved in pathology formation. Whereas we don't see Jung analyzing the self as being the cause of most of pathology. Kohut's self also gets radically transformed with empathic and self-object experiences in therapy. We don't see anything of that type in Jung's self. In case of manifestation in dreams, Jung's self manifests in dreams quite differently from the way Kohut says what he calls self manifests itself in dreams. So Jung's self essentially manifests in the sense of completeness or the desire for completeness, whereas Kohut says in dreams, what he calls self-state dreams. The self appears in dreams in a disintegrated, disjointed way, calling for attention to take care of its cohesion. So these two are very, very different. When we come to Indian spirituality again, the self is very different. One, self is that which goes from one incarnation to another, which is not there in either Jung or Kohut. Jung may be open to reincarnation, but he is not emphatic or convinced about reincarnation. He is not certain. In Indian spirituality, the self is not so much involved in direct pathology creation, but it is a carrier of karma. And the karma may lead to the creation of pathology. So if you look at Jung's self, Kohut's self, and Indian spirituality self, on the point of participation of self in creation of pathology, the Indian self will be in between the Jung's self and the Kohut's self. By being the carrier of karma, it definitely contributes in some way to pathology in the process. The spiritual self also is very different in the sense that in some Indian systems, what is called the self or the psychic being has to be brought forward and allowed to take charge of the organism as much as it can. And instead of the ego, we have to move the center of the psychic system to that psychic being. And once it happens, the psychicization or the purification of the whole personality happens, which is very different from anything mentioned in Jung or Kohut. And then another use of the word self in experiential terms is to realize the central being, which is above evolution, that also is referred to as self by many systems. And that is experience of oneness with existence. It's a supra-individual experience of the individual. Probably in that state, you don't experience yourself as an individual. So, and in more classical yogic systems, the self or the soul is also seen as a part of the model of the mind, where it partly imparts its influence to the working of what is called the buddhi, manas, and the ahankar. And lastly, there are phenomena of emanation and coalescence, where a part of the self or the soul goes out of itself without reducing the original thing and gets fused with something or somebody else. And at the same time, two of them can come together to be one. That also can happen. Alternately, some other personality with its own self can also take possession or get into another person and start influencing that person. And then we have this whole idea in Indian spirituality, I think in many other systems also, of transfer of consciousness, transfer of knowledge, transfer of attainments through some way. And in that sense, the self also gets transferred to somebody. Now, this is very, very mystical. We read about it in books. We also have some people who are alive today and who claim this can happen and this has happened to them. And so we have people and we have documentation. We still don't have anything empirical on this, but this is how the three domains of the meanings of the word self are different, and we are yet to put all of this together in a more coherent, all-containing theory.
So That will be like the synthesis of the East and the West.
Yeah.
At a very deep level.
True.
Yeah. You just mentioned that the self is personal in the West and transpersonal in the East, kind of. So can you explain this?
It's not exactly that watertight, but on the whole, it is true. If you look at it in general, it is true. If we go in details, Jung's self definitely has a transpersonal element to it, although he's in the Western part of the debate. So except for Jung, self in the West is largely personal and secular. Whereas in the East, it is largely transpersonal and spiritual. In Kohut, for example, the self is created, it can be improved, it can be healed, but it's completely personal and secular. Kohut doesn't talk about the larger purpose of the self. He may talk about the positive goals of the self or for the self, which we can give to the self. But he doesn't talk of any ordained purpose. So it's a very secular element of approach to self. In case of Jung, the self is very teleological. It has a transpersonal element of the collective unconscious associated to it. But it is still, I would say, not a reincarnational self. He may be open to it, but not certain. But you see that in the East, the idea of the self is very strongly tied to the law of karma and reincarnation. And that's a very big difference, because that creates a very different idea about the self and relation of the self to other parts of the personality. And that also creates a different sort of a transpersonal element to the model of the mind. One more element, the creation of pathology, therefore, has elements of past lives in the East, most often, not always, but that kind of thinking we don't find in any school of psychoanalysis in the West, not even the Jungian school. There are two important elements in the East with regard to model of the mind: the element of karma and the element of self journey, the journey of the self. And these two have a very strong bearing on model of the mind, working of the mind, pathology, and quality of life and the purpose of life. That kind of thinking on the self in the West, we don't find. And the self participates in mystical phenomena in the Eastern paradigm, whereas that kind of participation we don't see in the West. The self is also seen as indestructible and immortal. In the East, we don't see that kind of conceptualization of the self in the West. So these are some of the broad areas where we see differences on the idea of the self between East and West. And I think it's also important to make one more point. In the West, psychotherapists deal with the self. But in the East, it is largely the gurus who are dealing with the self.
Is the self and the ego different?
They are definitely different, except for some parts of Kohut where we get confused. And we don't know if we are getting confused or he is getting confused. but someone is getting confused, or maybe both of us are getting confused. But normally we say, and Kohut also says, ego is a part of the larger self. Or at times you say there is a self and there is an ego. But the more common part is ego is a part of the larger self, and the self there is equated almost to the whole of the personality. And then everything becomes a part of the self, including the ego. So that is one way in which many people use these words, self and the ego. Some people use this word self to mean the deeper part of oneself. To distinguish it from the superficial part of oneself. And there they use the word in the context of the persona and the self. That's a deeper part of me. And but the difficulty arises particularly when Kohut talks about the fact of cohesion. So when Kohut gets to this concept of cohesion and he starts talking about ego cohesion, certain points it's confusing whether self cohesion and ego cohesion are the same, whether the strength of the self and the strength of the ego are the same. Where a fragile ego and a fragile self are the same or different. So, and if they are different, then when we say the ego disintegrates, how does that affect the self, and why should the self also experience disintegration? Or if the self is an unhealthy self, why should ego be so fragile? So that is not very clear. So those are the areas of confusion between ego and the self. But usually, for most common purposes, ego is taken to be a part of the larger self, and self is usually equated to the personality, except for some cases where we refer to self as a structural component, as in Jung, or as a deeper part of oneself, authentic self, in case of some existential discourses. So this is how the two stand.
So as I understand, that means the ego and the self are not two fragmented or separate things, but they are two elements or entities of the same system.
Yeah. Is it? That's a safer way of putting it.
Okay. How does the self operate in the working of the mind?
Differently based upon what the meaning of the self you take it. If you use Jung's version of the word self, then the self is a coordinator. It activates and deactivates archetypes based upon the program of life for the purpose of individuation. And the plan of individuation is inherent in the self. The blueprint of one's life, the purpose is inherent in the self. And the self, if it cannot come forward because of too much of living in the ego or the external world or superficiality, then the self sends messages to attend to the exclusion of the self. In Kohut's view of things, the self operates in many ways. If the self is healthy self, we go on towards positivity, larger projects in life, good healthy ambition, a very happy and prosperous approach to life. Whereas if the self is not healthy, then it can end up as a psychotic self, a borderline self, or a narcissistic self. And all the three have fragility of different types, and they create their own challenges and pathological situations. So the self operates in this way to determine pathology and quality of life. When we look at the East, the self operates in a different way. One is to see that the self brings with it karma of the past and therefore imparts a flavor to the mind in general and pathology in particular. Second, it also brings fortunate and unfortunate incidents as a fiat accompli in the process of life. Third, it brings with itself its journey of life element, and therefore the particular stress on things we like or don't like, or we are drawn towards even if we don't like. And fourth, another way of looking at the self is to say in the Eastern systems that the self puts its agents in the area of thought, emotion, and biology. And through that, the self operates into the system. And the best outcome of influence of the self is seen in higher and purer emotions and motivations. So this is the way in which Jung, Kohut, and the Eastern systems, they see the functioning of the self in the psychological system.
Is there a spiritual way in which the self appears in our dreams?
Yeah, the self appears in the dreams in many different ways. Jung says it appears as symbols of wholeness or a desire for wholeness. And that can refer to something which is round or circular or spherical, or something which is moving towards a convergence and completion, something which is moving towards a closure. It can also appear as a symbol of purpose, to say what it wants to experience. And in Kohut's view, the self appears in dreams as a disintegrated, disjointed entity to convey that a healthy self is yet to be formed and self-object experiences are needed. Kohut also says that in some of the dreams, the self appears with an intention to communicate need for self-object experiences and experiences of mirroring and idealization of a very early time, so that the arrested process can be restarted and the self can move towards the position of a realistic, healthy, strong self. And in the spiritual systems, the self can appear in many ways. Most common is the flame, or it can appear as signs of symbols of completeness. Many times in the forms of very complete, elaborate yantras or mandalas, which are sorts of philosophical, geometrical expressions of philosophical theories of everything. And in certain cases, they appear as a collage, a very circular or spherical collage of different flowers or colors or different lights. These have been some of the very common manifestations of self in dreams as understood by different systems.
Is the self related to pathology?
If we use the word self in Jungian sense, then no. In the sense, it's not a cause of pathology. If we look at it from an Indian, from a spiritual point of view, it can be, because it carries karma of the past and the karma can create pathology. If we look at it from a Kohutian point of view, definitely yes. Because most of the chronic pathology in his view essentially is self-pathology. And because of that, because he describes the three unhealthy positions of the self, the psychotic self, the borderline self, and the narcissistic self, and in each of the positions, many sicknesses can come out. So he may talk about three different positions of unhealthy self, states of unhealthy self, but they may cover a large area of DSM pathology. So that is how it is related to pathology. And one more way it is related is, in some spiritual systems it is believed that what they call the psychic being, and they refer to that as self, if that can be brought forward by experientially experiencing it oneself and bringing it forward, that almost is like a wholesale solution to psychological problems. And that is how the self gets related in that system, not towards causing pathology, but as a wholesale approach to healing pathology.
So can the self be healed in therapy?
Again, we come to the definitional issue. If we look at Jung's definition, there's nothing to be healed in the self. What has to be healed are other parts of psyche, which are not allowing the self to fully express itself in individuation. But if we look at it from a cohesion point of view, definitely, I mean, it is the whole purpose of cohesion therapy to heal the pathological self. And that is done by a variety of techniques of self-object experiences, of empathy, mirroring, idealization, lack of impingement, right tension between the competencies and the goals, and living out one's deepest grandiosity and not being held back while living it out by a very deep-seated desire, deep-seated problem of shame. Indian systems, the self, the psychic being, is supposed to be brought forward to heal a variety of problems, both biological, psychological, and spiritual. And there, they have their own methods of how to bring it forward, not essentially in the therapy room atmosphere, but in a very different setting.
So maybe that, as you earlier said, there is a psychotherapist in the West and there is a guru in the East. So possibly healing of self in East is like it's done by a guru or in some group or in some satsang or some such place, I believe.
The process part of it is different.
Right. How does Eastern spirituality look at the concept of self in operation?
Many systems look at it very differently. Simplest of systems, they see the self in incarnation and reincarnation. And when the self carries the karmic element and the journey of life element, and these two are secreted into the more surface parts of the psyche. And from there, they act out. So it's almost like there's something before the personal unconscious, which is created out of this life's experiences. So there's something before that, and that renders a transpersonal element to it. So these are the simplest systems. And when the karmic element and the journey of life element for this life are worked out, the self leaves. And when the self leaves, it carries with it only the strongest of impressions, strongest of gains, and rest of it is allowed to disintegrate in the cosmic reality. And only those which are the strongest elements, strongest memories, strongest attainments, strongest regrets, and so on, they are carried on as the karmic stuff for the next part. And the accumulation of all karmic stuff is what they call is the, they give different names, they use the word Sanchit Karma, which is the accumulation of all the karmic part. And then a part of it is taken out for one incarnation, which they call as the Prarabdha Karma. Some people use different names, but the logical idea is this, that out of accumulation, a part is taken out for experience for one life. That is the kind of idea. Then there are more esoteric schools which talk about not only the functioning of this self, but other selves coming in and overshadowing this self or fusing with it, or part of this self going out and fusing with somebody else without impacting itself. So these are more esoteric theories about the self, of how emanation can take place, coalescence can take place, possession can take place, influencing can take place. So this second type of more esoteric theories. Third kind of theories in the spiritual domain, they deal with the kind of kind of transfer of self, if I was to use that word, where somebody who has attained a great deal can transfer a part of his power, idea, thought, spiritual attainment to somebody else in some way which we don't know. So that's another way some theories deal with that kind of area. And the most common and popular are the ones which talk about the self putting out its agents within the system to deal with the biological, emotional, psychological, intellectual, and spiritual areas. And the good parts that come out of the human system are under the influence of that part, those parts individually. And if you are interested, then in this system, one of the best systems is developed by Sri Aurobindo, where you can go into concepts of the psychic and the psychic influence on the physical, vital, mental, and supramental, and over, I mean, above mental ranges. So these are different systems, and they talk differently about the operation of self in the human system, as well as what was the genesis of the self, or where was the self before the birth, and what it is after the birth. So based upon which school you take to, you see a different account of this thing.
How does the concept of the authentic self fit in here?
The word authentic self does not actually get use the word self in the sense normally we use it in Jungian school or the Cohusian school or the Indian spiritual school. When we use the word authentic self, it's basically used from an existential standpoint, from standpoint of existential philosophy, and of course existential psychotherapy also. The meaning of the word self here has to do with part of oneself, a deeper part of oneself. So idea there is that there is something called a superficial self, the surface part of us, and a deeper part of ourselves, the more authentic part of what we are, the real us. And there you use the word authentic self to mean a deeper part of yourself, not to mean a structural component or a pathology causing component. So it's a different way of using the word, the authentic self, to refer to a deeper part of yourself, which cannot come out or express itself because of social situations.
You have coined three terms. One is surface self, the other is second is authentic self, and third is spiritual self. Can you elaborate this?
Yes, it just occurred to me that I actually put together these three rather than inventing them. I thought I had invented them, but now it occurs to me I have more correctly put them together. The surface self is dealt with by Jung in terms of persona. The outer part of us which we show to everyone, not the difficult part of us. So there is always this dichotomy of in every individual of the showroom and the godown. And the showroom is the surface self, what is put up on the window for society to see. And then there are those deeply private parts of oneself, at times good, mostly troubling, which we don't want anyone to see. And then there are parts about oneself which we ourselves don't want to see. So that part of ourself which we put up for everyone to see is the surface self. That part of us which deeply we are ourselves is the authentic self. But the authentic self has both good and bad parts. It may have more good parts, but also has bad parts. There is not, it's not a completely pure state. So when I become authentic, I become what I am, but what I am is not completely pure, it's a mixture. But then deeper than that is a spiritual self, where the psychic puts up its parts, and under influence of them, a very pure layer of the personality exists, which activates very rarely in us when we want to do all good completely selflessly. A very state of pure emotions. So that is the spiritual self. So I feel there are three layers: the surface self, the authentic self, and the spiritual self. All the three layers are there in the personality.
So is it like the surface self plus the authentic self equal to the spiritual self? I mean, I'm just trying to simplify. No.
If you want to put in an equation, I would say the if you want to put the personality, it is combination of all the three self plus the psychic being and the central being.
Which is the spiritual self?
The psychic is in that system that I am referring to. That part of the self which is in evolution is a psychic being. That part of the self which is presiding over but not involved in evolution, the central being. And the central being is in touch with that ceaseless anchor. That's the one particular school that I was referring to. The terminology is from that school.
Okay. Overall, then, how would you compare the concept of self in the East and the West? Like we have discussed in details, but overall, how would you try to put it?
Overall, I would say, in the West, the self is secular, largely personal, except for Jung, where there's a touch of transpersonal, involved deeply in the working of the mind and pathology formation, except in Jung, manifesting in dreams, and in many schools, the concept is completely absent. So we don't find this concept at all in Freud or Klein or Bion or many other theories. We do find it in Winnicott. He talks about the true and the false self. But that is almost like what we talked about, the surface self and the authentic self. So he uses the word self again in a different context. On the criteria of authenticity, a front which is put up and what is there inside. And for him, the goal of therapy is to move from the false self to the true self, which you can say in other words, is to be able to live one's authenticity. And the Western self is not involved in mystical or spiritual processes. The Eastern self is. The Western self is dealt with by the therapist, the Eastern more by the guru. The Western self does not enhance the reach of the human potential beyond the secular as you and I have accepted. But if we go to the East, the concept of the self and the description of the self enhances the limits of human potential. For example, the idea of attaining a state of no thought, of oneness with existence. These are all very central goals in Eastern spiritual traditions. But in the West, we can't even think, we think these are virtually impossible things. So the idea of limits of human potential is different, and that has to do partly with the way self is conceptualized, its present and its purpose they are given to it. So self, one more element, self in the West is by and large a subject of therapy, but in the East it is largely a subject of one's self-development and spiritual evolution rather than therapy.
Well, we come to our last question. Is it important to understand this concept for the quality of our lives in general?
Yes, because quality of life will not improve unless we do something about it. And the idea of the self takes us to the concept of quality of life. If we believe the self as a secular entity, even then we talk about individuation and authentic living and good living. If we believe the self to be a spiritual entity of reincarnational purpose, we then realize we'll have to pay for what we do and better to be good. Look at it from risk management point of view. We don't know what is true. The secular idea of the West is true, or the reincarnational idea of the East is true. And if one gets into risk management mindset, one can think of that both of them ultimately lead you to a more noble form of life. Both of them lead you to self-exploration, to enhancement of good in oneself, and to do a life which does more good to others than otherwise, and enhances our own quality of life. So I believe the very engagement with the idea of self, whether in the Western or the Eastern paradigm, both of them ultimately enhances the quality of life.
Okay, Mr. Vaidya, I think we've done a good job of dealing with this very complex concept of the self.
Right.
And thank you for throwing light on many, many different aspects of the self. Thank you so much. Do write to us at hvindia@gmail.com. Namaste.
Namaste.